afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and let me give a special welcome to members of the Noonan family. It's so good to see you here again. This is a special occasion for us. We're gathered here to the special court session to give tribute to our friend and colleague, Judge John Noonan. I knew John for 20 years, and he was on our court for 10 years before that. He and Mary Lee welcomed my family warmly when I joined the court, and we maintained a strong friendship ever since that time. The first time I heard about John was when I was working for a judge and as a law clerk in the summer, and he handed me a copy of Persons and Masks of the Law and said, "Everything you need to know is in this book." And the lessons of that book are as fresh and relevant today as they were when John penned them so many years ago. We're privileged here today to be joined by the Honorable Anthony M. Kennedy, Associate Justice of the United States Supreme Court. And Justice Kennedy, I'd ask you to give us a few words of remembrances.
Thank you very much. Is there a button for this microphone, or is it on? I'm not quite sure how it gets on. All right. Oh, it's most gracious of you, Chief Judge Thomas, for you and the court to ask me to be with you here. To convey to Mrs. Noonan and to the Noonan family my condolences on their loss. A life of 90 years is itself a blessing. But we know that this means the family he loved so much grieves all the more deeply the loss of so devoted a husband and father and a man of such conviction and decency. Please accept our expressions of deep sympathy. The first time that John sat on this court, it was my privilege to be the presiding judge of the panel. As the junior judge, he sat on my left. And my recollection of that first case is still very vivid. The appeals seem to have little merit, and my best recollection is that we gave a limited amount of time, say 20 minutes. John wasted little time in asking counsel about a citation which was part of a string cite or a footnote. And when it was apparent that the lawyer hadn't fully remembered or even read the case, John became all the more interested, and then he wanted to compare it with another case the lawyer had cited. And the way John started to talk about these cases, I looked to make sure that it wasn't Mulberry versus Madison. I mean, these were the most important cases of all time. And he started going through all of these citations, and I noticed that the counsel for the appellee was at the table. And he was not enjoying this at all because he knew that he would be next, and he was scrambling. So this went on for 10, 15, 20 minutes, and as a courtesy to our new colleague, it didn't seem to me right to really interrupt him and say that the argument's over. Plus the fact none of us had had any time to talk anyway because John was asking all the questions. So the first case took a little over an hour, and so I did have a chance to say, we'll have a recess. So we went in, and I said, "Now, John, you're going to be on this court a long time, and you will make your influences through the opinions you write, and not necessarily the questions you make of counsel. And I'm not sure that you can do much to educate the counsel." I'm not sure John agreed with that. But he was a little bit more quiet during the balance of the hearing. But it then became evident to me, and I think to all of us, that we'd been joined by a scholar of the first rank, a scholar of unyielding moral commitment to the law and to its teaching. The Ninth Circuit, Chief Judge Thomas, was honored then and is honored now to know that a scholar, a jurist, and a man of John Noonan's stature would be with us. He made all of us better judges, better lawyers, better human beings. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Justice. Before we proceed with the formal presentations, I have a missive from Judge O'Scanlan, who regrets not being here, and he spoke at the funeral mass, and he wanted me to read these remarks on his behalf. I deeply regret that I'm unable to attend this memorial for our dear late colleague, Judge John T. Noonan, Jr. I thank our chief judge who kindly let me share by proxy a few thoughts on John's wonderful life. I had the special privilege of working alongside John on our court for more than 30 years. We came onto the court about the same time, he in December of 1985, and I, his immediate junior in seniority, less than a year later in September 1986. By the time John and I met, I was well aware of his towering reputation as an intellectual giant. He was a prolific and prominent scholar, law professor and author, an historian of tremendous breadth, and a true Renaissance man. John tackled controversial subjects, contraception, abortion, marriage, sexuality, bribery, life and death themselves, and he did so emphatically and without equivocation. But as in all his life's endeavors, John wrote on these difficult questions with elegance and grace. There may be no more accurate testament to John's academic prowess than the fact that the institutions and renowned as divergent as Pope Paul VI, Bolt Hall at Berkeley, and the University of Notre Dame all sought his expertise. On the court, John's stature in the legal world only grew. He was a conscientious judge and a fierce defender of the rule of law. Although we diverged occasionally on some legal issues, we agreed on so much, and I am proud to have joined John in one of his most prominent moments in our court history, the majority opinion in 1995, involving physician-assisted suicide, a decision later unanimously upheld by the United States Supreme Court. Even with such a politically charged and morally contentious question, John's opinion displayed his characteristic compassion for and his deep engagement with both sides of the case. Indeed, far beyond his professional accomplishments, it was John's innate tenderness and decency which defined him, notwithstanding the fact that he demanded the highest ethical and professional standards from the lawyers who appeared before us. Anyone who knew John, regardless of his or her personal beliefs, was also deeply impressed by his understanding of truth and morality and his pursuit of goodness in the world, which permeated everything he did. In his scholarship, in his approach to law, and in his life, John cared most about people. His pursuit of social justice, both on the court and off, was unwavering. He was a man of abundant and constant mercy, and he exuded love. I will miss him deeply, and I thank him for the inspiration he gave to me and to countless others who were fortunate enough to enjoy his company. May he rest in peace. And now I'd like to call on Judge Kim Wardlaw to make the first of a series of remarks.
All right, thank you. Judge Noonan was a great man and a great judge. The loss of John was more than a loss of a colleague. It was a personal loss to me and my husband, Bill, and a tremendous loss to the many worlds that John influenced and loved. Bill would be here today, but he's in Boston, of all places, moving my daughter there, or our daughter there. John was a lifelong scholar, philosopher, and theologian, a man of deep faith who had the intellect and the courage to question institutional teachings, a judge with an abiding sense of justice, a man absolutely devoted to his family, especially Mary Lee, an amazingly accomplished person in her own right, and to his three children, John, Rebecca, and Susie, and their families. And finally, a good friend who cultivated many lifelong relationships. I am both honored and humbled to be asked to help celebrate his life here today. Bill and I knew John by reputation long before we had the privilege of getting to know him personally, because of our mutual involvements in the Archdiocese of Los Angeles and with the University of Notre Dame. We were often asked in reverent tones whether we knew John Noonan. Maybe it's also because we all lived in California. At that time, to name but a few, John had been engaged in politics at the federal and local levels, had been a professor of law at the University of Notre Dame at Bolt Hall, published Contraception, which led to his service on Pope Paul VI's questioned and ultimately led to the softening of the church's then position that prohibited contraception. And he had written numerous other books, articles, and papers on an endless variety of subjects, including classroom legal texts. However, it was not to be until 1998, when I was confirmed to this court, that we had the opportunity to begin a relationship that developed into a deep friendship with John, Mary Lee, and his family. When I joined the Ninth Circuit, John had already served on the court for 13 years and had been on senior status for 2. He had already written some of his most significant opinions, through which his abiding sense of justice and humanitarianism shone. Yet the court would have the benefit of his intellectual power for more than 2 decades after that, an exact overlap with my tenure that deeply influenced my development as an appellate judge. John and I sat together 41 times and decided hundreds of cases. It was always a great pleasure and a learning experience to sit with John, although I have to admit that the first time I sat with him, I was a little terrified. How could I possibly hold my own with this revered scholar? John had written about greatness in judges a decade previously, citing the 4 cardinal virtues of the ideal judge articulated by Aristotle in the Ethics: justice, temperance, prudence, and fortitude. But John elevated one trait above the others. He wrote, "A judge with no justice is no judge at all." John had a distinct writing style, clear, forceful, and powerful. Each sentence in his writing built upon not just the last thought, but the past body of his work, just as each work of authorship built upon his past scholarship as his thinking evolved and as he reached deeper layers of knowledge and insight. He was above all an educator. In Persons in Massada Law, he explained that teaching was the main activity of appellate judges, asking, for what else are 95% of their written opinions? And teaching was, quote, necessarily person to person, informing and evoking. His opinion in Compassionate Dying, whether or not you agreed with it, perfectly illustrates both the strength of his style and the role of the teacher he assumed. While demonstrating compassion for the plainest suffering, he wrote that compassion, unrestrained by other virtues, such as justice, prudence, and fortitude, leads to catastrophe, as illustrated by Dostoevsky's The Idiot. This is rich, deep, and thoughtful material, drawing on the breadth of his scholarship and worthy of reading just for its teachings. John thoroughly engaged himself in the process of deciding the cases as well. As Kevin Starr wrote in a 1995 biography, Noonan relishes the social interactions and consequent diplomacy of the appeals process, in which each judge, while functioning as an individual, renders decisions as part of a panel. John and I did not always begin on the same side of a case, but we almost always ended up there, having persuaded each other through the exchange of draft majority opinions and dissents. There is only one case that I can recall in which this form of diplomacy failed, that it was an AEDPA decision, which Judge Fisher and I were on, speaks for itself. As the program indicates, John never lost sight of the centrality of the other person as he courageously navigated the tension between respect for the rules and respect for the person. The case that symbolizes this for me is Ramirez v. Castro, a 2004 decision about California three strikes law. Isaac Ramirez had been released from prison after serving 5.5 years of his 25-year life sentence. A federal judge had granted his habeas petition and ordered his release after our court struck down the three strikes law under the gross disproportionality principle of the Eighth Amendment's cruel and unusual clause. The government appealed. While its appeal was pending, the Supreme Court reversed us and reinstated the three strikes law, holding that the gross disproportionality principle applied only in the exceedingly rare case. For a number of reasons having to do with the specific facts of Ramirez's 3 nonviolent wobbler felony convictions, John and I were convinced we were indeed facing the exceedingly rare case. For one, there were only two more severe punishments available in California: life without the possibility of parole, and death. And these were for crimes like murder, manslaughter, or rape. But it would take a certain amount of fortitude to confirm that the Supreme Court's opening for the applicability of the disproportionality principle to the extreme case really existed. That was according to Irwin Chemerinsky. We heard the case in Pasadena in July 2003. By November of that year, the opinion had yet to be written, and John and I were again sitting together in Seattle. After court one day, he searched me out, wanting to hash through all the reasons Ramirez's case was exceedingly rare. He then said, "If you can write it, I will join you." Well, I did actually write it, but it was John's courage and sense of justice that gave me, still a relatively junior judge, the fortitude to do so. John had aptly written about great judges. Here, as normally in a judge's life, courage is the crowning virtue. His words inspired me to try to follow in his path. I was amazed to learn that at the time of his death, he was still thinking about the Rodriguez issues as he left an unfinished project on the disproportionality principle, starting with this case, People versus Weems. And John did relish his social interactions with his colleagues. Whenever he came to Pasadena, he would bring Mary Lee and stay at the Athenaeum at Caltech, about a block from our home. We would take turns dining very formally at the Athenaeum, beginning with cocktails and hors d'oeuvres in the anteroom, and then moving into the formal dining room. Or we would dine at our home or another Pasadena restaurant. We exchanged ideas, stories, news of our families, and discussed politics and the church. We did not always agree on politics, the church, or the church's politics, but we were able to discuss these differences with respect to each other's views. More recently, though we continued to sip, John did not travel as much to Pasadena. Whenever I was in San Francisco, though, John would take me to his favorite restaurant, which was south of Market. Frigali, it was a French bass bistro, and we would continue our conversation. The very last time we were driving there, we saw Bernie Sanders and his makeshift entourage ducking into a coffee shop. That set us up for a lively political discussion. Needless to say, neither of us felt the burn. In March 2009, our son Billy was a freshman at the University of Notre Dame when University President John Jenkins invited the President of the United States to speak at commencement and receive an honorary degree. As a result, the university and Father Jenkins were widely denounced in the crudest of terms, as was President Obama. Protests with graphic images of fetuses broke out on campus. Immense pressure was brought on Father Jenkins to rescind the invitation. We received almost daily calls from Billy describing the ugliness of the protests and the barrage of flyers opposing the president that Billy had voted for. He questioned how to reconcile his Catholic faith, his love of Notre Dame, and his support for President Obama. When John spoke at the 2009 commencement, after Mary Ann Glendon rejected Notre Dame's highest award and dropped out over President Obama's participation, John answered Billy's questions perfectly. John's commencement speech evoked many of the teachings in his 2005 book, The Church That Can and Cannot Change. He told us that the matter was one of conflicting consciences, and the answer was not to hurt your friends, but prayer, patience, empathy, and the love that encircles the other person. John touched countless human beings when he said, "One friend," referring to Marianne, "is not here today, whose absence I regret. At the same time, I am here to confirm that all consciences are not the same, that we can recognize great goodness in our nation's president without defending all of his multitudinous decisions, and that we can rejoice on this holy, happy occasion." With this speech, John courageously stepped into a national moral divide, gave comfort to both sides, silenced the anger and the hurt, and created room for the love and celebration that commencement day should bring. What he firmly believed about the Catholic Church, he wrote, was that on the surface, contradictions appear. At the deepest level, the course is clear. So with deepening understanding, the Church's traditions could change over time, but that what is vital will survive as ephemeral as discarded. That we have a Pope Francis today demonstrates just how prescient John was. John has left us a remarkable legacy. We will miss him, but the lessons he taught us and his love and his friendship will endure. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge. We'll now hear from Bernard J. Cassidy, who is General Counsel and Secretary of Genotherapeutics and was a law clerk to Judge Noonan during the term 1988 to 1989.
Thank you, Your Honor, and may it please the Court. I'm Mrs. Noonan. It's not every day that the New York Times obituary describes a Reagan appointee to the federal bench as a polymath who defied ideological pigeonholing on profound issues. But those of us who knew Judge Noonan know he was not a defiant man. He was no rebel. He observed great respect for precedent's legitimate authority, often illuminated the heart of the law when applying it to specific cases. If he defied ideological categories, then perhaps the problem is how impoverished the ideologies of our time have become. To memorialize Judge Noonan today, I would like to focus on a handful of his writings, six to be exact. My goal is to illuminate his thoughts, and since we're all writers, to identify some pretty good pieces of writing. And I have in the back of my mind the goal of responding to a question that was raised or suggested recently in the Senate Judiciary Committee by our much beloved senator from California, Dianne Feinstein, who wondered, if not out loud, how can a Catholic be an appellate judge? I'll get to it. The first bit of writing is on courtesy to fellow judges. Early in my clerkship, I was assigned to review a draft opinion another panel member had circulated, which began with the usual recitals about how a case came before the Court of Appeals. Well before I completed my research and analysis, I encountered the following comment from Judge Noonan, quote, "Reversing, I would not name the district judge." A simple, sensible courtesy that would incrementally protect the public reputation of the district judge. Those privileged to work within the Ninth Circuit know the exchanges among members of the court can be pointed, even painful, as strong insights clash in developing a judicial opinion. But these private exchanges are not published, whereas the public collaboration is an absolute requirement for appellate work. In that simple sentence, Judge Noonan exemplified what many in this courtroom know was a well-established habit of public courtesy to fellow federal judges. Second piece of writing is from, it's a little longer, from the Antelope, the ordeal of the recaptured Africans in the administrations of James Monroe and John Quincy Adams. Good writers know how to set a scene. Here is how, in 1977, Professor Noonan does so. Quote, "In the end of June 1820, in the last year of the first term of President James Monroe, a ship flying the revolutionary flag of Jose Artigas was boarded by a Treasury revenue cutter off the northern coast of Florida and discovered to have on board about 280 human beings in chains. The conduct of the slave trade was a federal crime, and it was reasonably inferred that the ship, the Antelope, was criminally conveying the natives of Africa for sale in a southern market. For the next 8 years, they were to be the object of attention by President Monroe himself and his successors, President John Quincy Adams, Attorney General William Wirt, two secretaries of the Navy, the Monroe cabinet as a whole, the Supreme Court of the United States, headed by John Marshall, both branches of Congress, a variety of other administrators, officers, and judges, and the American Colonization Society. As the attention given to the Africans themselves by any of these persons or institutions was sporadic, they have been, for the most part, ignored by the biographers of the men of the Silver Age of the American Republic and neglected by the historians of the three branches of American government. If mentioned at all, as part of a lawsuit, the case of the Antelope, where their status as merchandise was asserted by representatives of Spain and Portugal, their names go unrecorded. Although their role was to suffer while their lawyers acted for them and other lawyers acted against them, they are part of a story which touches on the official conduct of Monroe, Adams, Marshall, and their turns out this is not a good story, but it's a good story to be told, as later writers Howard Moss and Church have observed. The American legal system failed the African captives. In fact, all three branches of the federal government and luminaries within them failed badly, in large part due to fraud and bribery. For nearly a decade, the African captives, who were mainly children, were bystanders during the legal battle. As Noonan later observes, under federal law, the Africans were free, and President Monroe was supposed to return them to Africa. They were claimed as property, however, by the Spanish and Portugal consuls, purporting to represent honest Spanish and Portuguese slavers, from whom they had been taken by a pirate, whose effort to import them illegally into the United States could not, the council said, work a forfeiture on the rightful owners. In fact, the Portuguese certainly, and probably the Spanish, were fronts for American slave owners, including Senator James DeWolf of Rhode Island, unable themselves to appear in court without admitting criminal guilt. In the litigation at the district court, Georgia's U.S. attorney, Richard Habersham, who sought the captives' freedom under the 1918 Slave Trade Act, was opposed by John Berrigan, later a senator, then a state court judge, before U.S. District Judge William Davies, who decided almost all the issues in favor of the purported Spanish and Portuguese interests. 1 week after his final order, which countenanced a gain of $30,000 to Berrigan's clients, Judge Davies resigned from the bench and joined Berrigan's law practice. The case then comes before the U.S. Supreme Court in 1825, the Marshall Court, where most of Judge Davies' rulings are reversed, and most of the Africans who had not died were freed. But unbelievably, to our 21st century eyes, 37 were still deemed to be property, which permitted some of the principal attorneys, who were also public officials, to be paid one way or another because of the inevitable future disposition of those persons would be their sale. After the Senate passed a private bill in 1828 to remove a legal impediment, and John Quincy Adams, then president, signed that bill into law, the 37 were sold. The attorneys, who were public officials, got paid along the way. Noonan tells the tale of the antelope, warts and all, to acknowledge and to teach that even a system with checks and balances can utterly fail if the persons empowered by the system fail, either through blindness or greed. Professor Noonan's interest in corruption on the part of political and public officials, of course, culminated in the publication of Bribes shortly before his appointment to this court. This would be our third example, and perhaps the most piquant. In discussing the two key personnel who ran ABSCU, the FBI's sting operation in the 1970s that resulted in 8 different juries convicting 96 different men and women, and it provides a wonderful contrast. The team was, quote, an extraordinary combination of the lawbreaker and the law enforcer, of the unscrupulous and the scrupulous, of the knavish and the conscientious and the astute. Out front was a first-rate scalawag, Melvin Weinberg. According to his memoirs, he was a liar and a thief as a schoolboy, dropping out completely in the 6th grade. Later, he was hired by a glassworkers unit to break the windows into employers of a non-used glazier. He cheated a cousin who befriended him with a position in his business. He swindled an insurance company. He took $10,000 from a doctor for a promise, unfulfilled, to kill the doctor's wife. Finally, in 1977, he was convicted of wire fraud in violation of federal law. On probation and desirous of keeping a girlfriend out of federal clutches, he agreed to become a con man for the FBI. That's pretty good prose so far, but now comes the stroke of genius. Teamed with Weinberg were the law-abiding, the dutiful, the conscientious, including a man congruously named Good. Supervisor of the FBI office, son of an FBI agent himself, imbued with the ethic of the Bureau, streetwise but disciplined, Good matched Weinberg's flamboyant gusto with his own intense and sober zeal. That sentence, teamed with Weinberg were the law-abiding, the dutiful, the conscientious, including a man congruously named Good, surely belongs in the Oxford English Dictionary as an example of how to properly use the word congruous. more than clever, it is revelatory of Noonan's implicit jurisprudence. The law is a human artifact and enterprise, imperfect at times, knotted with ambiguity and complexity. It develops through human effort, and individual persons, whether those who enforce or those who interpret it, make a difference. It is fundamentally good, but individual virtue is a necessity. Without good people, the law can be a monster. Speaking of monsters, now turn to our fourth writing, the case of Olympia Lazo Mahano, a refugee from El Salvador, whose husband fled. Pursued by guerrillas and the government alike. Olympia was essentially enslaved by Sergeant Zuniga once he learned that her husband had fled. She escaped to the United States. Here, an immigration judge ruled that she had not shown a clear probability or well-founded fear of prosecution on account of political opinion, and so was to be deported. The Board of Immigration Appeals agreed. Judge Noonan and the Ninth Circuit did not. He wrote, "Persecution is stamped on every page of this record. Olympia has been singled out to be bullied, beaten, injured, raped, and enslaved. Olympia's initial acquiescence does not alter the persecutory character of her treatment. As she continued to return to Zuniga's place after his initial attack upon her, presents a pattern all too familiar of a victim identifying with the aggressor under conditions of terror. Persecution has been conducted by a member of the armed force, a military power that exercises domination over much of El Salvador, despite the staunchest efforts of the Duarte government to restrain it. Zuniga had his gun, his grenades, his bombs, his authority, and his hold over Olympia because he was a member of a powerful military group. Uncontradicted evidence that point to both the clear probability of persecution and a well-founded fear of persecution." The dissent in that case stated bluntly that the holding was a construct of pure fiction. Quote, "Quite simply, the majority has outdone Lewis Carroll in finding that male domination in such a personal relationship constitutes political persecution." Well, first of all, it's troubling to call what happened between Olympia and Sergeant Zuniga a personal relationship. That itself may be deemed a public and political act. With the benefit of hindsight, and a view of our society's evolving self-understanding about social structures that underpin sexual relationships and relations between or among the sexes, it's fair to say that many of us do see male domination in personal relationships as a political statement. I think Judge Noonan may simply have been 30 years ahead of his time. With the case of Bette Midler's voice, to fans, Bette Midler is an icon, a star. To Ford Motor Company's agent, she was a talent to be used to further car sales. In advertising Ford's Lincoln Mercury in 1985 with a series of commercials and what the agency called the Yuppie Campaign, the aim was to make an emotional connection with yuppies, bringing back memories of when they were in college. Different popular songs in the 70s were sung in each commercial. The agency tried to get the original people, that is, the singers who had popularized the songs, to sing them. Failing to obtain the consent of Miss Midler, however, the agency had her song sung by a sound-alike, actually one of the harlots who had extensively performed in a backup role with Bette Midler on tour, Midler suit. This case required the Ninth Circuit to decide whether California law protected this use of Midler's voice. For the court, Judge Noonan wrote, "The defendants here used an imitation to convey the impression that Midler was singing for them. Why did the defendants ask Midler to sing if her voice was not of value to them? Why did they studiously acquire the services of a sound-alike and instruct her to imitate Midler if Midler's voice was not of value to them? What they sought was an attribute of Midler's identity. Its value was what the market would have paid for Midler to have sung the commercial in person. A voice is as distinctive and as personal as a face. The human voice is one of the most palpable ways identity is manifested. We're all aware that a friend is at once known by a few words on the phone. At a philosophical level, it has been observed that with the sound of a voice, the other stands before me. A fortiori, these observations hold true of singing. actually singing by a singer of renown. The singer manifests herself in the song. To impersonate her voice is to pirate her identity. Sixth, the case of Robert Alton Harris. Scheduled to be executed, he petitioned on multiple grounds, and the question came down to whether there would be an evidentiary hearing before his execution occurred. Judge Noonan wrote, in 1985, in Ake v. Oklahoma, the United States Supreme Court established a new, previously unknown right, the right of a defendant on trial for his life to have effective psychiatric assistance if his mental state was at issue. If the defendant was too poor to pay for such help, the state had a duty to provide it. The right and corresponding duty were created by the Supreme Court, finding in the Constitution this requirement of fundamental fairness. Most new constitutional rules are not applied retroactively. If, however, the rule enhances the accuracy of the determination of the facts and goes to fundamental fairness, the rule is applied retroactively. The Ake rule is of this kind. Applying a rule retroactively is upsetting. The rule was not known at the time. The state was innocently ignorant of its duty. The defendant and his lawyer were unaware of what they could ask. Retroactive application means recreating the earlier proceeding and asking, what did the defendant have a right to if the rule had been in effect? The answer is a right to effective psychiatric assistance provided by the state if the defendant was too poor to pay for it. Harris was too poor to pay for it. He alleges he did not get it. The state says he did. No evidence was taken. We have only allegations, declarations, affidavits, and arguments, none of them tested by cross-examination. If Harris's claim should be true, he is entitled to a new trial as to his sentence. If it should not be true, he must face execution. We must therefore take the time to let a federal district judge hear evidence and decide what the facts are. An evidentiary hearing must be held. As we know, an evidentiary hearing was not held, and Mr. Harris was executed. What does all this tell us about John Noonan as a Catholic? Or, put another way, what do Catholics think of John Noonan? Catholics believe, as do all major religions, that there is a reckoning, some type of judgment after death. In some religions, it is a question of karma, or the mysterious byproduct of predestination. But Catholics believe there is a personal judgment by God of our actions. In support for this proposition, we look to a narrative in Matthew's Gospel, at the end of time, in which all nations are gathered before God, and people are separated as a shepherd separates his sheep from the goats. You've surely heard this account before. To some, God says, come, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, you visited me. Those selected are surprised, which I think is the main theological point of the narrative. They ask, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? When was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? When was it that we saw you sick, or in prison and visited you? God responds, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of the members of my family, you did it to me. John Noonan, in his capacity as Judge Noonan, understood and exemplified this teaching about the centrality of the individual person to basic human fairness and to the law. By protecting the good names of judges whose decisions are reversed, by acknowledging and teaching in bitter detail how the law failed the enslaved Africans, by recognizing the otherwise uncelebrated goodness of the law enforcer, by sheltering a rape victim from deportation, by upholding an artist's gift against corporate exploitation, and by insisting on due process for a convicted murderer. He was faithful to this essential part of Catholic dogma, and we believe he was a good judge. So, Senator Feinstein, it's possible for a Catholic to be a good judge. Thank you.
Thank you. Our next next speaker is Richard W. Painter. As Walter Ritchie, professor of corporate law at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, and former chief White House ethics lawyer from 2005 to 2007, and a law clerk to Judge Noonan from 1987 to 1988. Mr. Painter.
May it please the court, Justice Kennedy, Mrs. Noonan. 30 years ago, last summer, it was a very busy time in my life. In the summer of 1987, I was married to my wife. I was back with our children in Minnesota now. I was starting a new job right out of law school. The most interesting job, and I would say the most wonderful job that I've ever had. I've had other jobs that are certainly a little bit more strenuous. I will not comment on what I've done in government or in the corporate world or in academics, but my job with Judge Noonan, right out of law school, was fascinating. It's just a wonderful place to work, the chambers of Judge Noonan, with Karen and Evelyn and my co-clerks, Sophie and Doug, learning about the law and how the law affects people. To prepare for my clerkship that busy summer, I read two books by Judge Noonan, Persons and Mass, the Law, and his lengthy book on bribes. I got a lot of remarks from my law school classmates about going off to clerk for a judge who had written a book hundreds of pages long on bribes. Very interesting. Those two books told me a lot about Judge Noonan and what he wanted to do as a public servant, as a Christian, as an American. First, bring humanity to the law. That law is not just about abstract principles, but about the people affected by the law. That is the message of the Persons and Mass of the Law. That we look at the person who is injured in an accident at a railroad. We don't just think about abstract principles, but we think of the person and what alternative legal rules might mean to a person who suffers a serious injury. We might think about the people who are enslaved in Virginia, and Judge Noonan wrote about that, and the way the law worked to affect people's lives, the way legal rules affect people's lives. And more recently, I watched Judge Noonan in the 1990s and the early 2000s struggle with the immigration question and how the laws set up in our immigration system affect people. And in his view, and I agree with him, deny due process in many instances to immigrants, legal and illegal in our country. Judge Noonan always thinking about the people who are affected by the law. We don't just see an abstract concept when we make decisions about law, whether it's in the judicial branch or in the legislative or the executive. Do we think about the people, the children of immigrants? We've had a lot of debate about that quite recently. And now the children of refugees, to what extent are the people in the executive branch, the legislature, and the judges looking beyond the mass of the law and the legal rules and thinking about the impact of law on human lives? In the recent debate over immigration, I heard many people say, well, are we a nation of feelings or are we a nation of law? And I think the answer from Judge Noonan would be both. That law should incorporate our feelings, our emotions, the way we treat each other, the way we believe we should treat each other, that there is a room for that in law, in a civilized society. And then Judge Noonan's book on bribes, and the threat that we have had in civilization over thousands of years of corruption, not just at the judicial branch, but at the executive and the legislature, through bribery. Things of value offered to decision makers, to powerful decision makers, way they might ordinarily make those decisions, but because of the bribe, the influence, the undue influence that was bestowed upon them. I recently went back to that book and looked in the back of the book for a discussion of the emoluments clause of the Constitution. I've been doing some work on that. That is only one of many, many ways in which society over thousands of years has struggled with this problem of undue influence, whether it be undue influence of foreign government, undue influence of the church, undue influence of the executive on the judiciary branch. And it's critically important that we continue our fight against corruption in our own country and abroad. Judge Noonan gave us so much to think about in his scholarship on honesty, integrity, and ethics. I co-authored a casebook with him, Professional and Personal Responsibilities of the Lawyer. We have quite a few cases there which discuss the undue influence on decision makers, from the county commissioner of Massachusetts who owned adjacent property to the property by which he was making the zoning decision, to judges who served on the board of trustees of nonprofit organizations that would benefit from those decisions that they made, to the most egregious example, the judges in Germany during the 1930s and 40s who allowed politics, political ideology, to usurp their understanding of the rule of law, to stand down as judges and allow the takeover of a country, of a judicial system, of a legal system by ideology. And we tell that story, the trial of the judges and the prosecutors in 1947, part of the Nuremberg proceedings. I teach that to my students, hoping that they would understand how important it is for us as lawyers, for judges, for those who serve in the executive branch, and in the legislature, to stand up for the rule of law. But these are difficult times now, and I am confident that with you as judges of this court, and Justice Kennedy and your colleagues in the Supreme Court, that you, all of you, can continue to stand up, stand firm for the rule of law in the years to come, and that we, as members of the bar, and in the memory of Judge Noonan, who cared so much for people, for the rule of law, for honesty and integrity, that we can continue to carry on his work here on earth while he rests with our Lord. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll now turn to Judge Stephen Reinhart to give some concluding remarks.
Mary Lou Noonan, family of Judge Noonan, friends. A number of words have been used to describe my friend, our friend, John Noonan, most of which you have already heard today. A giant, a humanist, a moralist, an ethicist, a polymath, a word I had to look up when I first read it. He was a true intellectual, a man of learning, but more important, he was a man with a heart, a man of empathy and kindness. As he said in his speech entitled The Heart of a Catholic Law School, quoting Samuel Johnson, the business of human beings is kindness. He lambasted the bureaucratic mind, and he included in his speech examples of the bureaucratic mind at work even from our own court. This is in which a lack of empathy and humanity, he believed, led to the overriding of justice in the name of bureaucratic, formalistic, rigid adherence to rules. These cases, in John's view, could easily have come out the other way had the judges involved only recalled that the ultimate purpose, the ultimate goals of rules and of law, was to achieve justice. In his famous John made it even clearer. As he put it, fascination with rules can lead judges to engage in conduct that they would otherwise recognize as evil. In short, John Noonan was not an ordinary judge. He sometimes upset some of his colleagues with his bluntness, his outspokenness, his demand that we all abide by his values, by the law as he saw it. Some had a different perception of their role as judges, surely a legitimate one, and they sometimes arrived at results of which he did not approve. But to him, it wasn't personal. He just had difficulty understanding why everyone did not see what to him was elementary. Yet despite those disagreements, no one could doubt that John was indeed a unique and a remarkable individual. Whatever one might think of his approach to the law, how much better off would today's judiciary be with more Judge Noonans? I first met John when he came into his initial court meeting, and after being introduced to us, delivered an impassioned lecture on the failure of both lawyers and judges to perform their functions properly, and then walked out of the meeting, leaving us all stunned. Nevertheless, or actually because of this, I thought to myself, I'm going to like this guy. And I did. We became friends, and I became a fan. I often wished that I could be as outspoken as he was. And as principled, even when we disagreed very strongly, as we did in Compassion and Dying, a case his obituaries all called his greatest opinion, and which, when I wrote the unbanked case reversing him, I made it clear I thought was his most erroneous judicial opinion. Despite that, we remained friends. As to why the Supreme Court reversed me and affirmed him, that's another matter for another time. I think often these days of how badly the moral values of John Noonan are needed in our nation today, and wonder how, over his last few months, he would have expressed his total disbelief of much of what we now witness daily. I remember his respect for the Constitution and the rule of law. I remember his belief that in implementing those legal doctrines, we must first and foremost be guided by the principles of morality. I think of how his respect for all the institutions on which this nation is built, including the judiciary, must be preserved and strengthened, and of how he thought it was a primary duty of our public officials, from top to bottom, to provide that moral leadership. I think also of John's dedication to social justice in the best traditions of his Catholic philosophy, of his concern for the poor, the oppressed, the disabled, and all others in need, and of his belief that it is the obligation of all of us to help them. And I remember especially his love for immigrants and refugees, and how he would, yes, even as a judge, fight to see that they are treated with the compassion and fairness that he believed that his God and our Constitution demand. In John's passing, immigrants and those seeking refuge in this great nation have lost a true friend. Yes, we will all miss John. I will miss John. His family and his country will miss him. I am proud to have been his colleague and honored to have been his friend.
Thank you. John was a man of great courage, conviction, empathy, and morality. But he also had a good sense of humor. I don't want people to leave here thinking that he didn't. He had a wonderful laugh. And he fiercely loved his family. Mary Lee, thank you for the opportunity to share our remembrances of John with you and the members of the family. Thank you for your friendship. And to John, Becky, and Susie, I don't recall a conversation that I had with him over 20 years when he didn't speak of you with such great pride and wonder at not only your accomplishments, but your character. This concludes our session. I would just say that when good men die, their goodness does not die with them, and rather it endures. Thank you very much.